This is Comics in Real Life, and we have Penelope Bagieu. Actually, what I'm going to do first is go through everybody's introductions and show you a couple of slides from their books, and then we're going to jump right into questions with the authors that I'm moderating. I'm Meg Lemke. I'm the editor of Mother Magazine, and I also run programming at the Brooklyn Book Festival. So first we have Penelope, and she has a forthcoming book, which you can see here, California Dreamin'. It's published by First Second in English in the US, and it's about Cass Elliot before the Mamas and the Papas. Her book, Exquisite Corpse, was published by the same press in 2015. In France, she's a best-selling graphic novel author, and her editorial illustrations have appeared widely in the media. She blogs, drums in a rock band, and watches a lot of nature shows. That's a piece from the book I love. Nick Bertozzi's new book, Becoming Andy Warhol, is co-created with illustrator Pierce Hargan and recently published by Abrams Comic Arts. Bertozzi is the award-winning and New York Times best-selling author of Shackleton, among other titles. A contributor to Nickelodeon, Spin, Gourmet, and New York Times, among other publications, Bertozzi teaches at the School of Visual Arts in New York. That's a double-page spread from Becoming Andy Warhol. Fox Brown's new book is Tetris, The Games People Play. It's from First Second as well. Box is an IGNAPS award-winning cartoonist, illustrator, and comic publisher from Philadelphia. His book, Andre the Giant, Life and Legend, was released in 2014, and he was also a New York Times bestseller. His second graphic novel, which is Tetris, as I said, just released. He's also the publisher of the independent house Retrofit Comics, which started in 2011. This is Nathan Hale, who's the only one who actually sent me a picture of himself. I really like this graphic of yet another New York Times bestseller. He's the author and illustrator of the popular Hazardous Tales series, which are published by Amulet Books. And this new one is Alamo All-Stars. Hale is the illustrator of the graphic novel Rapunzel's Revenge and its sequel, Calamity Jack. He also illustrated Frankenstein, A Monstrous Parody, The Dinosaur's Night Before Christmas, and many others. Oh. And those are a bunch of his books. You can see they're super popular. I was telling him I handed one to a kid on the way over here, and she was amazed. And finally, not for kids, is the comic book Story of Beer. Aaron McConnell and Mike Smith have created this book for 10 Speed Press. Mike Smith has worked in breweries, large and small, for the last two decades. He's currently head brewer at Back East Brewing Company in Bloomfield, Connecticut. And here you can see a two-page spread from the book, which is very detailed, both in research and in illustration. Aaron McConnell has also illustrated the U.S. Constitution, a graphic adaptation, and the Gettysburg Address, a graphic adaptation, as well as various other nonfiction, historical fiction, and fantasy comics. He is a graduate of the Rhode Island School of Design and a member of Periscope Studios in Portland, Oregon. Thanks, you guys. So those are just a snapshot of their books, and then we're going to go into questions. So first up, this is a panel about nonfiction comics and what is real. I wanted to ask you all, going one by one, about your research process. So starting with Penelope, and here's a beautiful piece from the book. How did you start researching the early life of Cass Elliot? And how did you find your story?
Well, I kind of feel like a fraud because it's not really a biography and not much of it is true. So I didn't research much because I think, to me, that's how it works. The more I try to stick to reality, the worse it is because I can't write. I need to imagine things. What I like to do is fill the holes more than knowing the truth, because the truth is not necessarily very interesting. And that's also why I chose someone that there is not much literature about. I mean, I could have chosen Janis Joplin, but I chose Cass Elliot on purpose, because I think she has one or two unauthorized biographies, and she's usually a line in other people's biographies, but you don't know much about her. So there was this great freedom of telling pretty much what I want. And
you're
projecting.
Another unauthorized biography, basically.
Oh, no, it's not. It is so not a biography. I mean, it's funny because there's this undertext, a mama cast before the mamas and the papas in the U.S. version. And in the original French version, they were like, oh, no, no, we don't want to put this because people will think it's true. And it's not. It's really, really not true. So the dates are actual and the people she met, but the rest, it's just me. Because I think a biography or even a landscape, anything, it's just you. And you're just telling about yourself in a disguised manner. So it's more a biography of me, actually. So.
Did you research the period? Did you think about, you know, in terms of coming up with the dialogue or the kinds of things that people might say? So if you're thinking of this more as historical fiction, did you research the period itself?
Not really either, I'm sorry. No, the only thing the only thing I actually did intense research about was more graphic stuff like furniture, the way that the hairstyles and things like that, because the story runs roughly from the attack of Pearl Harbor to someday in 1965, and it's kind of dense, so I wanted to have elements that helped you, because I never wanted to have any subtext saying, and this is now 1952. So since I didn't want to put any dates, the background and the characters had to give as much clues as possible. So from what did a TV set look like there's the same place at several different times. So the TV set changes from one scene to another and you have to immediately understand that you're no longer in the 40s. So I was more careful about graphic accuracy than really the story.
I'm going to move on to to Box, because I got the alphabetical order wrong. So Box, tell me
I
about...
screw that up all the time.
Yeah. Tell me about your research process. This story is not only known in certain circles. Alexei's story is also disputed, and I wanted to ask you about that. When you talk to someone who has a lot of kind of complicated histories and interpretations of their story, particularly in a world like the Games world, which is really tight. Mm-hmm. How did you go about reconciling that as you chose the story that you wanted to tell?
Well, I mean, for me, it's just, in the beginning, I'm like looking for anything I could find written about Tetris or written about Alexei himself. And that spans, you know, internet articles, but also, you know, newspaper articles and magazine articles that have been transferred to the web at this point. Any books I could find that mention the Tetris story and YouTube videos a lot. YouTube has been like, not so much on this book, but my next book. Spent a lot of time finding actual footage of things, and it's incredibly helpful. It's really, if you think about what research was like when I was a kid, it was like, would have been, I don't even know how you would go about it without the tool, the internet, because there's just so much there. And documentary film, actual video of them talking and trying to get the mannerisms correct. I'm not sure what the dispute is you're talking about, actually.
I guess I'm not, I think I'm referring to the fact that over time, the lawsuits around Tetris were used in ways like as propaganda, you know, between the two countries in the Cold War. Mm-hmm. And then you give very short time in the book to the controversy with his co-creator who killed his family and himself.
Right.
So I think that shrouded in a sense of tragedy. And then Alexa, you know, he's at the University of Washington now.
Mm-hmm.
I think this idea of this genius who had this lost time and how it reflects, I don't know, there's this
right.
cool panel.
So,
but it's a hard topic to write.
Yeah, I mean, you know, when Vlad, the thing that happened with Vlad was something that surprised me without giving too much away. One of the co-creators of Tetris later on in life, in the 90s, killed himself and his family. It's called family annihilation, and it's something, a phenomenon that happens from time to time, sadly. But I felt like I had to put that in there. I mean, I couldn't shy away from it. And even if it's hard, you know, difficult subject matter, but it fits kind of in with the theme of the book, which is that, you know, capitalism isn't without its problems.
Right.
You know? One of the themes I've been talking about this all weekend, but one of the themes is mo money, mo problems. You know what I mean? Like, but it's true. I mean, you know, you look at lottery winners or things like that, you know, that's not, doesn't fit, you know, cancel out all their problems and issues. And so one of the things about Alexei is that, you know, everybody knows that he didn't make all the big money off Tetris when it was a big hit. And they think of that as like this huge tragedy when he, through this experience, besides not making billions of dollars off that, he learned who he was. And he went from being a scientist to a creator of games, which is his true calling in life. And so that, to me, is a far greater reward than, well, $1 million. I mean, how much money is... Maybe there might be a sum that would be better than that, but... Right. But, you know, so, yeah.
I could really talk about this book all day, so I'll move on to Nick Bertozzi's Becoming Andy Warhol. And you also chose to focus in on a very particular period in Warhol's life, which is right before he became famous and kind of the characters that got him there and who he left behind. So can you talk about why you chose that period and what this book was about?
I've always felt insecure about who I was, and I've always been mad that there are people that can do things that I can't do, and I want to tear them down a little bit. I want to bring them down to my sad level. And so I've done that with Picasso, I've done that with Meriwether Lewis of the Lewis and Clark Expedition, I've done that with Shackleton, and I like to see their feet of clay. And the same is true of this Warhol book. I hate that we're taught, at least in the art school or the art history classes I've taken, we're taught that he's this god that we receive from this mountain, and we go to the churches of MoMA and PS1 and the Metropolitan, and we worship at his altar. And I don't like that. And so I did some research about him, and I realized that he's a person like a lot of us, and he started his gallery career as a failure. He couldn't get a show in New York, and the shows that he did get in LA were failures. The Campbell Soup Can show was a colossal failure. I think he sold six of the 32 paintings, and I don't remember which flavors they were. And he also, when he had his show, they call it Personality of the Artist, that we probably have all seen images of, the famous Brillo boxes, amongst many other brands, the facsimiles of the boxes. By the way, those are all screen printed. We can get into that later, but if we don't have to get into that, I should say. But that show was a colossal failure as well. And it wasn't until he did these very banal flower series that his fame turned. And it all also was, his fame came a lot from the people, greatly from the people that he knew and the circles that he ran in. And I wanted to illustrate that. I wanted to, not that I illustrated this, by the way, this was drawn by Pierce Hargan, a terrific young illustrator. But I wanted to bring out his humanity and show that a lot of it, his success is luck. And he had a great, terrific color sense, and he was an amazing, he had an amazing eye for about 4 or 5 years, and then he just tanked and hacked his way through the rest of his life after that. And that's my personal judgment, but I think a lot of people come up to me and say, oh, I really don't like Warhol, what's this book about? And I say, well, it's this story about this young man, and he goes from being the biggest commercial illustrator in New York to risking it all to become this gallery artist. And they just know, most of us in this room probably know Warhol as the Studio 54 lizard crawler denizen. And I think that doesn't, so it's a backhanded compliment to Warhol to show this period of his life when he was so was pushing the boundaries. And so yes, I'm making him human, but I'm also avoiding that period when he becomes just a celebrity whore.
You had something of the opposite problem than Penelope, because unlike you're saying, Cass Elliot hasn't had a lot of written about her. Warhol has been well covered in the literature. Did you have to apply a filter to decide what you weren't going to draw from?
I was able to, sorry about that, just making sure. I was able to make up a lot because Warhol made up a lot. So that gave me license to just play with his personality and his character and a lot of the dialogue. I mean, we don't have a recording of a lot of his dialogue. And as a matter of fact, his autobiography called, oh my gosh, I thought of this the other night and I can't remember. I think it's called The Philosophy of Andy Warhol. It was not written by him. It was written by one of his assistants. And some of it is what Andy said, maybe. And maybe some of it's not. And then there's thousands of books about Andy Warhol, and they're all from these different perspectives of people that met him for 5 minutes, people that knew him for 2 years, people. But no, I think the real point of Warhol is nobody, there's no true Warhol, and so I was able to make him my own.
Sorry, Penelope, too, that I've been using the French pronunciation. I was telling her earlier that I was corrected to use Penelope by a critic I know, you know? Because it's the French pronunciation, but this is really what this is about, right? Is interpreting, like, how, like, what is real, and it's up to the person whose name it is to tell us, not our idea, right, of what you're, how you should be seen in the U.S. So let me move on to Nathan. And this is a page from Alamo. Can you talk about your research process? And I really am particularly interested in how you think of this as an educational work. Because you're very clearly not trying to follow an idea of a real scene, because you have fictional characters popping in to narrate, for example, but you are trying to teach real history.
So my books are for younger readers. These are middle grade books. Were published by Amulet, who also does The Wimpy Kid. I think Amulet hired me because they were tired of parents complaining about The Wimpy Kid. And they said, do you have anything more educational? Because my kid doesn't understand that Greg Heffley is an anti-hero, and he acts like him because he thinks that's how he's supposed to act. And so I think that they picked me up to be like, here's a brand muffin of educational comics that your kids will enjoy. These are, the one place I do step away from realism is my narrators. My name is Nathan Hale, and my narrator is the spy Nathan Hale, who was executed right here in Manhattan in 1776. He is telling all of these stories to stop his execution. So my narrators do break into the story. Other than that, everything in here is very carefully researched and very carefully fact-checked by Amulet Books' incredibly thorough fact-checker. This guy goes through these things and sends me the meanest, snarkiest notes. It's like, oh, really? Is that how you think it happened? And I try to go as wide as I can to as many sources as I can. So I read a whole lot of books about the subject. I try to get primary sources where I can. Once again, YouTube is a super amazing resource where you can watch documentaries that are no longer available anywhere else. But I basically go to my library and check out all the books on the subject, and I will read all of those books, and the ones that I really like, I will go and buy, and then I will outline all of those books, and I'll underline everything, and I'll make all of my notes to create the manuscript, but that's only half the research, because these are comic books, and you have to know what everything looks like, right? So you can't just fake. Here's what's totally fascinating to me about the Alamo. There were no cowboy hats at the Alamo. The cowboy hat in that style had yet to be invented. Right? This was the 1830s. These guys were wearing top hats at the Alamo. David Crockett is so well known for having the coonskin cap. And there is a period drawing of him wearing a coonskin cap. Now, it came out after he was dead, so it could be propaganda, but that's the point where you have to make the choice. Do I give David Crockett his coonskin hat? Yeah, we got to give him the hat. We got it. But, you know, there's wiggle room. And I try to go for the funnest place the wiggle room allows. Because since these books are for kids, I don't want them to read them like a textbook. I want them to read them, who are these crazy people, and they're gonna fight some guys, and some explosions are gonna happen, and they just get sucked into the story. My ultimate audience is a kid who reads the book because it's exciting, and then turns the last page and sees all the bibliography and the historical photos and paintings and stuff and goes, wait, that ridiculous story was real! And they get excited. That's my ultimate goal. But yeah, top to bottom, research for the names and dates, and then the costumes. The book I'm working on now is a World War II bomber book, and the amount of research that I'm gonna have to do to get every single part of those planes right, and the pilots right, and the interior of the ship right. Now I just, and yet, as you can see, it's in a very cartoony thing, but it packs more of a punch. It feels more exciting if everything looks right and looks real.
Do you think about Common Core and the curriculum needs as you write? I know you're not writing a textbook, but do you feel totally divorced from that?
Yeah, I know there is a thing called Common Core, and I know that they want to have some nonfiction in it. But I want to draw exciting stories that give me chills, and I want readers to experience the excitement I felt when I did the research and go, this is magic, this really happened, this is exciting. I'm not tailoring it to school needs or anything like that. Like, I've had teachers come up and say, oh, we love your books. In fact, we've assigned everybody to read them. And I'm like, nobody's going to like it now. So Common Core.
Interesting. Okay, that's a whole other conversation, too. My daughter just started public school. So I want to move on to beer. Mike and Aaron, your book is hugely meticulously researched. What is it, 7,000 years? What is it you say in the beginning?
9,000 years. 7,000 BC to the present.
Thank you. So how did you both accomplish that span and that detail and still keep it in a reasonable trim size?
Well, one of the we are a trio. Jonathan Hennessy, our other co-author, could not be here today. But the way I describe it is I'm a brewer. I've been a brewer for almost 20 years, and so I mean that helps. I've heard one of the things that I really pride myself, I'm very proud of, is that in beer in particular, there are lots and lots of myths that have been perpetuated for years and years and years, particularly. Because with, you know, a lot of people who are now professional brewers of very high standing actually started out as hippies in the 70s trying to stick it to the man and make beer cheaper in their backyard on their own. And so a lot of the early brewing texts have lots of myths and holes, and, you know, they've filled in blanks in certain ways. And one of the things that I've done just as an aficionado and as a professional brewer is separate, pardon the pun, wheat from the chaff, in, you know, knowing, like, when someone says, oh, IPA was, they sent it to the sailors for this reason, it's like, well, that's actually not exactly how it happened.
So you're correcting the record with this book.
Excuse me?
You're correcting the record with this
I'm
book.
I'm correcting the record. We try not to do it in a, we always do it in a positive, but I'd rather tell the story in a positive way than negatively point out something that's wrong. I just tell the proper story rather than point out the myths. Mm-hmm. But we had the wonderful advantage of Jonathan is a meticulous researcher as well. And so one of the things that, you know, I did in particular was sort of fact check Jonathan. So, like, Jonathan was, we were both, obviously, all of us were researching independently and together, but I had a...
I did, you know, the littlest amount of research. You can say it. You can say it.
Yeah. But I was a check and balance situation, because, John, there are a lot of things in particular. As an example, there's this one story that has been perpetuated for years and years and years, is how, you know, India Pale Ale was made in England. This is all true. India Pale Ale was made in the Britain and sent around in ships to India where they were to consume it. And there's a story that a ship carrying this beer was leaving England, and a storm came up and was shipwrecked, and the casks of beer washed up on the shore, and the townspeople found them, and they're, oh, what's this beer that went to India? It's totally baloney, but it's extremely dramatic.
Right.
And I almost went to, John and I almost came to a head, because he wanted this in the book so bad, but he wanted the, you know, because, you know, there are a lot of, like, some of the, Aaron's very good at drawing dramatic scenes, and, you know, he just wanted this storm-tossed ship and the the drunken revelers finding the beer on the shore and all that, but it's just not true. And so is Jonathan. He's like, well, maybe we can draw the panels and then say at the end it's not true. And I was like, no, we can't do that. We can't be part of the, you're part of the solution or you're part of the problem.
I didn't get to vote on that.
I nixed it before. You got the beer flood, though.
What is the real subtitle? Because I was joking about the 7,000 years, but it's 7,000 BC? What can give me the full span of the book.
The exact, I don't know it offhand, but it's the story of the world's favorite beverage from 7,000 BC to the present.
It covers a lot. Aaron, to give you the follow-up question, one thing I found fascinating was you do move from these really dramatic historical scenes to scientific illustrations, essentially. So you're both exploring the history and the science of beer making. Can you talk about how you balance that in terms of thinking about like how you drew the process? Did you do research to represent it accurately?
That's from the third chapter, which is mm-hmm. about the brewing process. And, there's a lot of cartoon metaphor in that chapter to explain what's going on with the molecules and the enzymes and the fermentation and all that. So there was plenty of range for me to kind of get cartoony, which I enjoy doing. And in that chapter in particular, the book starts out, in prehistory. My studio is too small and it's a mess all the time because I have these, I do a lot of Google research, but I like to get the books from the library, the illustrated history books and all those DK publishing books and just kind of stack them up in my studio when I'm working on a project and have a terribly imperfect system of bookmarking because I can never remember where I want to find stuff. But, the book, if you read it or flip through it even, it's like a flip book where, the prehistory gradually becomes more refined because I'm working from photos. You can see where it shifts into photo research being available, and I kind of hope that the book reflects kind of the influence of all that stuff that I see, because if you look through these books, you start to recognize the same photos that get reprinted a lot, and that's kind of like the 101 part of learning the subject is like becoming familiar with those photos.
That's fascinating because you're essentially saying like you had to imagine the look earlier on because there wasn't photographic research, and then the book becomes more accurately reflecting the real as we move forward. That segues really nicely into the next set of questions I have, which is about representational art, and as these artists or artist teams choose to draw the stories, they're making a choice to show something that is essentially not real. It's drawn, it's imagined. Even when it's very accurately reflecting reference art, it's still their interpretation of it. And Penelope, you already said essentially you felt that in drawing it, you were making it your story. So I'm gonna give you my immediate offbeat question, which is what were you listening to, thinking about in your own life while you were choosing the art style? Because this is quite different from Exquisite Corpse as well. I felt like it was a departure.
Well, the difference with Exquisite Corpse is that I was 7 years older, actually, and that changes a lot. Because it's even though it came out last year, Exquisite Corpse, it's a very old book that I made when I was younger. So it's basically the same way of drawing, just getting older. So, I mean, it's the same way of drawing since I was 3, but just getting older. So it's not that different. And I don't think I was in a different state of mind. I was just older. What I was listening to, oddly enough, anything but the Mamas and the Papas. Because really, I had enough of that. No, because, it's not a very romantic way of talking about making a book, but it's such a long work that I think the very intense, exciting phase where the muses are talking to you only lasts 10% of the making, and the rest is just a very long road of just doing your page every day. And then you just listen to podcasts, anything, just to, you know, be a company while you do it. But you don't necessarily need inspiration, or it's always a disappointment to people who are not artists when you say that. But I mean, like for this one, it's a 300-page book. For 2 weeks, it was very exhausting and intense, and I was writing the story, and I was, and like you wake up at night to you know, note one last thing, and it's like you're in love and you're crazy. And then for a year and a half, you just, because every day you just do your page. And when people ask you, so how's it going with your book? And you're like, well, I'm page 134. Tomorrow will be page 135, and that's all. So what I listen to is anything that helps me getting through two summers and two Christmas with the book. So
the art in this book really defines the characters. You know, Cass Elliot has this incredible, or Elliot Cass, what am I getting? I'm turning it around. She has this incredible flair with the way you've drawn her. Did you have an inspiration for that in the art style, or were you thinking of other than her as a person, but like who was she in how you were figuring her on the page?
Well, I always have a very difficult time to have my characters looking the same all the time, because I'm always amazed by people who can do it like that, because, you know, it's very hard. Maybe if you have worked in animation prior to that, it helps. I don't know, but not for me. So what I usually do is at the beginning of the book, I decide who it is among the people that I know in my personal life.
Ah.
And that's the only way I can imagine what they look when they laugh, when they cry, when they're mad, because otherwise it will make no sense. It's not always the same person. So I just think like my neighbor or that guy who was with me in high school or anything. And then it's very clear in my mind, and I'm sure that I'm not imagining anymore. I'm just life sketching this person that I know in my head, so it's easier. And as for Cass, I knew that she and I were going to spend a long time together, and that my main concern was I must not get bored of her. Mm-hmm. I really must love her enough to, you know, make her smile and dance and cry and be mad and everything for 2 years. So before I begin, make sure you're going to love her because she's going to be with you for a long time. And so I remember that I write a lot before I start to draw, because that helps me. Probably it's a reflect from high school, I don't know, but I need to write a lot before. And I didn't want to draw the first panel until I was sure I had her. Mm-hmm. And because of that reason, I sketched like crazy for weeks until I knew it was her. You know, like you're even like doodling on the phone and you try to be, you know, to do it absentmindedly, like just drawing, and then one day she's here and she's coherent. Like you're like, okay, this is a real person that I can work with for a long time. And also I think because in this book they're mean persons, and I had to make sure I really hated them. And that, because it's the same, you need to feel the same way towards them that the hero does. Oh, I thought it was me.
Thank you. Nick is always a gentleman.
No, it was too long anyway. So yeah, so it's I'd say that what really matters is how I feel towards them. I need to really love the hero and be ready to draw it for 300 pages, to hate the bad guys, to, you know, to really make them look like bastards, you have to hate them.
Like revenge drawing them.
Yeah, but not necessarily because they're ugly, you know, but just to have mean eyes and, you know, to inspire you, oh, you have to hate them for real. And same thing, in this book, she falls in love with a guy, and he's not technically a beauty, but I needed to feel the same way towards him that she feels. So to be in love with him, even though he's not like Brad Pitt, and coincidence, I went through images and I found out that he kind of looked like my boyfriend. So I decided, this is it, he's just my boyfriend, and that will make it easier. And so it's him all the time. And of course, he didn't recognize himself, as usual, which is kind of humiliating for me. But the people that I have in mind when I draw, sometimes they will look at the book, and I'm like, oh, I hope he doesn't notice. And they don't, because I'm not a good drawer enough. So people never think it's them. But and so he did. At the end of the book, he said, he reminds me of someone, but I can't tell you who. And I said, well, it's you for 300 pages. How come you didn't notice? He didn't, and no one noticed, so, you know.
That's really funny, actually. So we're back at out of sequence to Box. Box, I was fascinated by the way, uh-oh, there went our art. Hopefully it'll come back, but I can ask you the question. Oh, good. You really did play with the look of Tetris with the book. Can you talk about that, the way you tried to use, you used geometric shapes throughout the work?
Yeah, that was kind of like a coincidence, kind of, like, because before I started working on the Tetris book, I was doing these fiction stories using, really refining this geometric style, using rulers and stuff all the time. And it was just so happened that I came upon this Tetris book, and it would involve drawing boxes and shapes and stuff all the time. So it kind of just worked out that way. I mean, I was even going through a period of time where I was using rulers to create the characters, and so their bodies would be all distorted with flat arms and things like that. But I'm trying to draw the characters more naturalistically. I have the same issues that Penelope talked about, where as long as the characters are recognizable from page to page as the character, I'm okay, but they don't ever really look the same from page to page. None of my characters are ever really like on model. I just can't really do that. So sometimes like Alexei looks chubbier than he is, and sometimes he looks skinnier, and however it works out, like he has a few defining characteristics, mostly a beard.
So we change a lot over the course of our lives. You put him through a long period of time.
Yeah, that's true.
Sometimes he's smoking more than not.
That was also kind of an accident. I was drawing, it wasn't this page, but one of the pages where I was first drawing him, and I was composing the page, and I was like, this, if he had a cigarette, it would be great to go to add this thing to it. And I was like, he probably smoked. I mean, it was the early 80s, like in Russia, they didn't really talk about like the health concerns yet. And eventually I was able to find something he had written that he was a voracious
smoker. Oh, so you confirmed that later.
Yeah, yeah.
That's hilarious, because it is very defining in the character in the book. You know it's Alexei because he's smoking. But I do think comics are like games in that you read them you interact with them as you read them in sequence. Right, and there's a comparison between the rise of text adventures and the expansion of the culture of video games is relating to the way that comics have expanded in our culture. So was that something you were kind of doing in a meta way with this book, to draw a book about games?
Yeah, kind of. I mean, I think that I comics and video games are kind of similar, and not just in that sense, but also in the sense that they're both art forms that often aren't considered art forms.
Right.
And so you are an underdog in talking about them. Like you say you do comics, people immediately have a certain understanding of what that is. And so I feel like it's always like, no, not those kind of comics, something else, You try to convince them that it's worthwhile or something like that. And same thing with when I did my book about Andre the Giant, pro wrestling. The same deal, where it's, you're hard-pressed to find people to agree that pro wrestling is an art form. Those themes I drew from life, you know what I mean? Like, where I was trying to make an argument throughout this book that games are, a true art form, just like painting, just like any literature, like movies, when video games first became popular in the 80s, in the 90s, they were very much seen as a frivolous children's toy that was rotting their brains and turning them into zombies and all this stuff. And these are the same things people said about comic books in the 50s. These are the same things people said about the novel in the turn of the century.
So speaking of forms that are diminished, like pop art, and then became popular again, here's Warhol, and you used an illustrator. You didn't draw this yourself. You worked with Pierce, who's a co-creator of the book. I noticed some things you did, like the kind of Lichtenstein effect with the, what do you call that, the little dots?
Moiré pattern.
Thank you. Did you make other choices to try and reflect Warhol's style with Pierce in the look of the book?
It was very, that choice was driven by the fact that the Warhol Foundation has been known to be litigious and not
representing the style on purpose.
We had to move away. I think there's the, the way to use images by other people is you have to make them, the copyright law in the United States anyway says that you have to make them transformative. And so for the Warhol book, since we were using all of his images, it was important to make them look like they were drawn and not to just trace them. And so that pushed that decision. The Warhol Foundation has since sanctioned the book and said it's...
Oh, good.
It's a, I guess the word was a formally sanctioned book. At least that's what the publisher told me. And James Warhol has seen it, the nephew of Andy, and said, yeah, this go for it. This works. This is fine. So we've got through that travail, that problem through the skin of our teeth. It was good.
But you did make other references to pop art from the period, like the effect we're just discussing. And then I also thought you used color in a really interesting way to drive the narrative, like with the purple dots on the piece of art. It's a two-color book, is that correct?
Yeah. Yeah.
And black and
violet.
Sorry?
Black and violet.
Yes, and you use the violet in interesting ways to move the narrative.
I'm just going to sound so mercenary, but that's, ironically enough, that's very similar to Warhol, isn't it? The color choice was because that was what the book was budgeted for. Mm-hmm. Really, I shouldn't say that in public, but that's the truth.
No, it's okay, that's what we're talking about, what's real.
So one of the good things about that is that it forces you to make interesting design choices that you wouldn't normally make with full color or with four color. And so it was the same reason I chose Pierce to draw the book instead of drawing the book myself. It was a mercenary choice. I thought, well, it takes me a year to draw one of these darn things, but it takes me 3 months to write it. I think I'll try writing instead of drawing so much.
That's a very Warholian decision, as you share in the book's narrative. Yeah.
That's between us.
Right. as he has his assistants put together a lot of his art. So I'll move past to Nathan. I want to ask you about the style also. So you've already gotten into this in your prior answers, but how did you think about, I guess across your series, how have you thought about the ways that your hallmark style has had to change for the periods that you're covering?
So you're asking me if I have a fat Garfield and a skinny Garfield period? Is that what you're asking me?
Or I guess it's just what kind of hats is he wearing, right? But
I'm trying, but I've learned that kids really like looking for those changes over time. Like they like, hey, look, this is an old Charlie Brown. Where you know, look how weird Snoopy used to look. They kind of enjoy that, and I think that my characters have evolved a little bit like that over 6 books. But I don't really change the art style too much from book to book. Mm-hmm. We do the same one color, you know, black plus one other color. The color for the Alamo was yellow because I figured there'd be a lot of sand and a lot of, earth tones and stuff for this book. But some of the books with more serious subject matter, I did a book on the Underground Railroad and we kept it very realistic in the way that people were drawn. I did a book about a Civil War ironclad battle where kind of inventors were racing to build the better ship to shoot each other with, and that got really cartoony. We made the people, we turned one of the characters into a fox because his last name was Fox, and it makes him easy to spot in the book. So really it just depends on what the subject matter is. I want the story to read better than anything else. I don't want to get lost in, like, intricate layouts or crazy things. I want you to just be able to pop from each scene, get wrapped up in the excitement and drama of all of it, and, you know, read it and be excited.
Sorry, I'm only changing those slides because we keep losing them. You actually brought up something I wanted to ask you also, which is that in the work and the way you depict characters, you're making decisions about an interpretation of that is that represents nations, that's their racial differences at the period, that reflect also on potentially contemporary tensions. Mm-hmm. And especially since you're writing to children, how does that affect your artistic choices?
It's, you know, you just want to be as close and true to the subject matter as you can be, but you also want to be as interesting as possible, too. I did a World War I book where I knew I didn't have enough colors to separate all the armies from each other, so I made every army into their national animal, right? So here comes the Russian army, they're a bunch of bears. Here comes the British, they're a bunch of bulldogs. Here comes the Germans, they're a bunch of golden eagles. Everybody's their national animal, right? So we get to the Americans, what are they gonna be? The Germans already got the eagle. They gotta be bunnies. I know that sounds goofy, but kids get so exciting when those marine bunnies show up and have the Battle of Belleau Woods as bunnies. But I grew up with political comics. I grew up during the Cold War, and I would read all of my, you know, regular comics, Garfield and everybody, and then I'd flip over the page and check out those political cartoons where, like, a big Grim Reaper was sticking his finger on a button, and there was, like, an elephant and a donkey, and I didn't know what was going on, but I knew it was real. And I thought, this is scary, and I love it. I don't know what this means. And I absorbed all of that kind of political, you call it cartoon metaphor. I really love me some cartoon metaphor. That's where the books really take off. You know, like, in this Alamo book, cholera comes to town and kills almost a third of the population of the American South down into Mexico. And of course, in a comic book, you can make cholera a big scary monster. And now kids are like, cholera looks cool. And I'm like, I know, it's gross with the skulls and stuff. So cartoon metaphor has got to be one of the highlights of doing this kind of book. Absolutely.
Speaking of cartoon metaphor, what were your influences, Mike and Aaron, in the artistic style and those choices? It really reminded me of the graphic classics from the 80s and 90s, you know? I mean, I loved some, like, you know, Wuthering Heights by Rick Geary. were those specific references, those cartoon history of the world type era books?
Yeah, well, further back than that for me, I love the EC stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I was into superhero comics, and then I went to college, and I decided I was going to be a fine artist. I was going to draw and paint, and then I went to school at RISD, and I took a class with David Mazzucchelli, the comic artist, and that just spun me right back around to my roots. And, he was showing us stuff that I hadn't looked at because I was enveloped in all that superhero stuff, like Harvey Kurtzman's Frontline Combat and the use of pages in a pattern to form repetition that the changes create, like, staccato accents, and then there's usually a big splash reveal at the end. That just really got me excited, and that's probably what I love most about doing the nonfiction stuff is, like, coming up with these kind of layout patterns that are invisible to the person reading it, but make the reading experience easy and clear and, you know, swift. Because, it's like you were saying, Nathan, about you don't want to get too hung up on especially with some of this nonfiction stuff where there's a lot of text on the page. You don't want them to have to read a lot of text and then look at an intricate drawing. You want it to all kind of gel together.
You also referenced classic advertising, I think, for example, in this page. And as I said, I thought the previous one about the brewing process was referencing a kind of like a scientific poster showing the stages. So did you bring that in, Mike, at all?
We call them Meet the Beers. Mm-hmm. One of the things, like, throughout the book, we tell the general story of beer, you know, beer, but in the narrative, there's not a lot of time to get really specific. So we have these, they're almost like little adverts. There are 9 of them through the book right now, but like they're more specific nuts and bolts. Aaron came up with this nice little steampunky graphic that we do for all the different beers. We almost look at them as like reference, like flashcards, where it tells you like, this is how bitter it is, this is how dark it is, this is how strong it is. Mm-hmm. And then we can use like just really text heavy, you know, like, again, that it gave us this really text heavy area for me to geek out or to placate the beer geeks who really want specific answers to specific questions. And then we call them the glamour shot. So for every type of, you know, we did the porter and IPA, and this is the American lager, where I call them glamour shots. So I would like find like the most delicious looking example of that beer, and I email a picture of that to Aaron, and then you reference the advertising. And so for all the different ones where the style of beer is in a replicated font. So this is basically like a Budweiser type font. Mm-hmm. And then a lot of the other beers there, you know, Hoegaarden, Wit beer, like the font, because like you talk classic advertising. Classic beer labels and beer advertising is like some just really striking graphic design from back, you know, pre, like when there was like just little regional breweries you can really see that development of that over time.
Definitely some cartoonists in the Pacific Northwest have done beer labels too. Am I right?
Oh, yeah. Well, there's one, the Brooklyn Defenders.
Brooklyn Defenders at the floor. I saw that. There's a beer company on the floor at Javits. How are we doing on time? 5 minutes? Okay, so I had more questions for you guys, but I want to bring some questions to the audience. And if it slows down, I'll go back to my questions. I'm just going to leave this slide up, which is that one thing that's interesting about these nonfiction books is all of these topics have a fan base. And so now these authors are entering into the period of finding their audience, which is really a long-tail marketing question in some spaces, you know, like, games has a very specific market. You guys are the audience, so why don't we see if you have questions along those lines as well. We have this amazing mic that, you can go ahead and throw it. I'll defer the pleasure, which you can throw to people.
Questions?
So question, go ahead, throw this lady the mic.
And you want to speak into it.
Okay. You have to catch the mic.
speak into it.
Go for it.
So I've just written my first graphic novel, which is based on a true story, happened in 1803, and it did very well, actually, for our first book. It was nominated for an Eisner and a Harvey, and so I'm looking at the next one. I'm doing shorter pieces. Question I have, though, because they are so labor-intensive, and I do tons and tons of research on these true stories, if you factor out superheroes, and if you factor out memoirs, you factor out teenage angst. You know, like, that's where I see, you know, they're all over there and we're here, right, in the annex. So I guess the question, and it's really heartfelt, is there really a place for those of us who want to tell true stories in whatever range, from mostly made up to extremely highly researched? Is there really a niche, and is there a place for the marriage of this stylistic, you know, comic book style with true, serious stories? Because if not, I'm going to do something else, like learn to play piano.
Well, all of these books have been published, so I think you have a good model there. But Box, why don't you pick that up, because you're also a publisher.
I say, heck yeah. I think that, you know, superheroes is such like a big, bold thing that's in your face all the time. But the book market is enormous, and graphic novels are growing within the book market. So we are growing and moving away from that to a different audience, really. Well, a lot of people buy their comic books at bookstores and not at comic shops, and I think that's where the audience is for this.
And while I have to say this, this is BookCon at New York Comic Con. BEA, which does take over Javits, which is fully a book show, has huge showings as well for comics. And Brooklyn Book Festival, which I program, we always have an enormous audience for our books, and we are really a show that takes comics to a book market. Nathan, what about you? You've been, several people here have been New York Times bestsellers.
I'll tell you where these books are crazy popular, in the school library.
Right.
In a fifth grade school library, I'm like a big deal. They get excited. At Comic-Con, not so much. The kids are inundated with these multi-billion dollar pop culture icons, and it just all day long, Captain America, Batman, you know, Nintendo, all of this stuff is just pounded into their brains. And so when they find a comic book that's about something that's real, it's almost like a whole new flavor that they've discovered. It's like, ooh, I've been eating all of this sweet candy. This is kind of salty. I like this. And they, I thought I would only attract a few weirdo readers, you know? Turns out there's a lot of kids that are very excited by true stories. And they want to know more. They want to learn. They want to get into it. And then they want to show off how smart they are to their parents. And then the parents are like, we got to get more of these books like this. And the whole cycle repeats.
I have to say, too, like, when Andre the Giant came out, I thought, like, only pro wrestling fans would ever read this. But I've had people come up to me and tell me they never read a comic book before and they don't like pro wrestling, yet they love my book. So I think there's people out there that love comic books and just don't know it yet.
Penelope, can you actually speak to the differences in the French book market and the U.S. book market in this area?
It's funny because that's exactly what I was thinking. I come from a country where no one reads superheroes. So right. It's exactly all the things you've listed minus the superheroes. People only read true stories and memoirs and things like that and historical thing and documentaries and comics. That's all we read. So I do like everybody else over there. And I have friends who are struggling to try to publish superhero stories in France. And they're like, but is there a place for us? Are people going to read superhero stories? I don't know. So it's just the mirror image of here. No, because the actual figure is that I've read that last year there are 1,200 people making a living out of comics. That includes people making the colors, the writers, and that's not much. And when they say making a living, trust me, it's barely making a living. So no, you don't want that either. No.
Too much competition there.
Sorry?
Too much competition there.
Let's take another question, because I think we officially have 1 minute left. I got the okay to go a little over, but, oh, you've got the cube. Go for it.
Yeah, I'm actually going to be piggybacking on something that you mentioned earlier with regards to Common Core, and I'm approaching this as a parent, and I'm not saying this in, like, a negative way, but actually in a reassuring way. Do you guys think that part of your success is that you know, it's not a textbook. You're providing this information to students in this new, well, not necessarily new, but in a different way that's a little bit more exciting. It's not just words on a paper. It's words with
images.
Yeah,
those leveled books are deadly. They're no fun. Sorry, that's just being down on Common Core. Sorry, Common Core. Did you want to ask a specific question as well as
no,
a parent?
No, do you think that is it a detriment to the industry? Like, do you think that it's helping you guys out or hindering your process?
To clarify, are you asking if the way that schools right now are standardizing curriculum, particularly in New York, but also certainly in Texas, which is a huge driver of the textbook market across the U.S., how do you see that interacting with your work? And maybe this is going to be particularly for Nathan, but I think also a lot of readers are going to be coming into comics, coming out of the current school system. Do you have thoughts on that? Is that a good
kinda, yeah.
Summary? Yeah, feel free to interject, too, if you want to be more specific.
I think the attraction to comics is kids want to read them, and it makes them, it's fun to read. I know plenty of young, reluctant readers who, if they see a big novel with a lot of words, they'll be like, I don't want to read that, but hand me that. I'm just going to read that on the way home, mm-hmm. Which kind of leads them into the habit of reading. But I think that's the key with all of our books. The comics are fun to read, so that's why we make them. And I think that's some people, maybe not so much anymore, want to take the fun out of learning. But we're trying to keep the fun in there. I guess.
Well, that's one of the things with the success of our book has been, you know, beer, obviously not in the school curriculum
right.
because it's beers. Maybe graduate school or
put that in the grade
after,
school curriculum.
It's for the teachers.
But the just general history, like beer, everyone, like walking around, actually to your question, walking around the, we had a great successful con this year and last year. Our book came out last year. We had a very successful con for both. And it's like you see people walking down, like not zombie, but overstimulated.
Some literal zombies.
Some were zombies, yeah. And then you see beer, and they're like, whew, they come right across. They're like, oh my God, I like comics, but, you know, enough Superman. Beer, this is the best thing. Or like my father, we get so many Christmas, sign it to my dad, he's a great beer fan. But a lot of people, I can speak from experience of being a beer geek for a long time, a lot of it is super dry. Like, beer is the most fascinating story from the dawn of time to now. It's amazing story, but they've still managed to write boring books about it. And so, like, our co-author John had the idea of, like, let's make this beer book. It was just, that's the brilliance of the idea is, it's like, yeah, these are great stories that people aren't learning because they don't want to read a 400-page textbook that's translated from German. But it's like, hey, you know what? You throw some tidal waves in there, and then suddenly it becomes this like really accessible, interesting story. And also, like, our book has that history, but also has like technical science stuff in it. And my girlfriend said to me, like, I've been telling her these things for years and years and years and years. She finally is like, oh, I get it now. The Lego, the starches are held together like Legos, and then the Lego man cuts the starches apart.
Yeah, visual
sugars,
thinking.
And
is
it's
a
like,
real
oh,
thing.
I get it now. It's like, okay, on two pages of Aaron's art that we helped work together on, it's like 100 conversations that I've been trying to tell you for 8 years now. It's like suddenly you get it.
Comics are a really efficient way to get information out of there. I mean, there's a reason
picture is
why.
Picture's worth 1,000 words.
Yeah, there's a reason why on every airplane you get on, the thing that tells you the most important information if you get into a plane crash, it's essentially a wordless comic.
That's awesome.
You know, and you pick it up and everybody reads it and knows what it all means, you know, and there's no words at all, you know. And so that, you know, that says that it means a lot. I mean, like, when you pick up a book that has no pictures, just words, that's a commitment of 40 hours or whatever it is, however long to take you a book, to take you to read that. But a 300-page graphic novel might take you an hour or two to read.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's efficient, you know what I mean? And you're getting the same information in without...
And you remember it, and you recall the photograph, your brain...
You saw it.
Yeah, your brain holds the pictures better.
I also think, and I make this argument a lot of the story and argument is carried by the art, right? So that, and that's an interesting way when we think about children reading and as we grow into readers, that it's an interactive process both with you and interpreting the text, but with the visuals and the text interacting, and that it can access something for some learners that they're not able to do immediately with text alone. And it's really useful for, we've used the term reluctant readers, but if you're not in the education world, that's something to say is a reader who's feeling that they can't do it or they don't want to read, and they're under an immense pressure within the school system, but they might find in a comic a sense of accomplishment because it's allowing part of their brain to access information in a new way.